still on and Higgs position measurements, and it's in particular our sensitivity to light core Q-covers.
Okay, thank you, Andy. I will talk about probing or the possibility to probing light quarks Q-cover. It's mainly about three works, one in the past with Soreq Delannoy, Tobias Golling, and Gilad, and about the exclusive Higgs decay with Alex Kagan, Gilad, Frank Patriello, Stonaev, and Yuri Zupin, and about recent work in PROGEX about Higgs to charm and the direct probing of this with also Gilad, Manuel Stamo, and Tobiaka from Weizmann. So Higgs in the Higgs in the standard model has two main rules. One is the induce of the electroweak symmetry bending, the mass of the W and the Z. This part was tested in a quantitative way by the direct measurement of the Higgs to the WW and the ZZ, which are consistent to the experimental accuracy with the standard model, and indirect by the electroweak precision test. In addition, it has very other important rule is the induced fermion mass, which is much less we know about this rule of the Higgs. Mainly what we know is about the tier generation U-covers, the tau, the bottom, and the top, which have expected to have the larger signal strength in the standard model, but we don't know too much about the light quarks, and in particular, the light quarks. And we can do a significant progress in this direction, and we want to test, we can test this. So I will continue with the introduction, then talk about probing the Higgs to light quarks coupling, and the establishment of the Higgs non-universality couplings in the up sector, in the up quark sector, which you can already say this now with the current data, mainly using the Higgs to BB bar search in the vector association channel by recasting this data, then describe the exclusive Higgs decay and the way that we can probe the Higgs to up, down, and strange U-cover, mainly if there, this one, any one of these U-cover is above its standard model value, there is a sensitivity, and we'll end up with some future rough estimation about all these methods. So we're talking about Higgs and flavor, we talk about the U-cover couplings. The U-cover is a unique interaction in a standard model, is a flavor-dependent interaction, unlike the gauge symmetry, which are flavor universal. And we have a very simple and sharp prediction, at least in trivial level, what we expect from the standard model, that this U-cover are proportional to the mass, and they are diagonal in the flavor space, no off-diagonal at three level. Also, we measure at the LHC the signal strengths. We'll use it during this talk, this mu's, which is thus the production times the branching ratio over the standard model expectation. And this kappa are the normalized to the standard model coupling to some of the Higgs to some mod, mod X. It's the ratio for the standard model. Let's keep it in mind. We use it. So this is the map of the fermion, of the standard of the known fermion besides the neutrino. This is the electric charge, and this is the expected U-cover from the standard model. And what we, the data that we currently know, the current measurement is in the green, about the tau bottom and top. So we have single strength Higgs to tau pairs and bottom pairs, and the direct information about the top is coming from the TTH. A bit, and these are the these three numbers are the naive averaging of the Atlas and CMS. We see that TTH is a bit above the standard model, but not something significant. And we have upper bounds on the light leptons, about the muons and the E signal strengths. And I quote here the upper bound on the muon signal strength. And we can do a simple exercise from the tau and the muon signal strengths. We can take estimate the upper bound on the ratio, and this below 15, and what we can deduce from this number, that the U-cover of the muon is much smaller than the U-cover of the tau, because in case that of universal Higgs couplings to lepton, to charged lepton, we accept this ratio will be more than about 280. So this is first, one piece of information that we can deduce just from the data. And now we can ask about these four guys, the strange, down, charm, and up quarks. What we can know, what we know about them indirectly from the, all the X data directly for try to probe them, and if there's any hope to probe them in the future. And moreover, does this Higgs couple like the mass to the light quarks? or it's just other mechanism, it's hints for new physics above, beyond the standard model. It can then there'll be some kind of new physics that have universal effect on the Yukawa, and we'll see it only in the light quarks, which this relative effect will be much larger than on the bottom Yukawa or on the top Yukawa. The challenge for probing light Yukawa, the standard model predicted branching ratio are tiny. The largest one of these four is the charm, about a bit less than 3%. The QCD background to identify these particles is, with the flavor tagging is a big challenge. At LHC, only charm tagging is possible, which is a relatively new technique. Already Atlas used it in the charm squark searches in the past, in the last year. And it's opened the hope and the possibility to use it in other search for Higgs physics. There are two passes to probe the light quarks. The inclusive way, by using the tagging, the B or the charm tagging, where for the LHC, only charm tagging is relevant. Question about the ILC or FCC, about the strange tagging, it's possible, I don't know. For the charm, it's possible for the LHC, and the exclusive way, which is just a rare decay of the Higgs to some vector meson, a specific vector meson, and the gauge field can be a photon, W or Z. We'll focus on a few vector meson with the gamma, the other is still work in progress, and this possible in principle or to the up, down, and strange, and for the charm. And already this month, Atlas put the first bound on Higgs to J psi gamma cross section. There is already bound on this exclusive mode. So what we know from the current data, and can we end the stabilization of non-universality in the quark of the up-type quark Yukawa? On the charm Yukawa, we can get some information which from the sources. Direct constraint by recasting the W Higgs, the Higgs association production where the Higgs decay to bottom pairs, and there is acceptance to charm. We'll see, we take the advantage of a few working points, a few different tagging efficiency for B with different charm contamination, and we can recast it and put direct bound on the charm Yukawa. It's a weak bound, but it's direct one. We can interpret the recent result of Atlas to Higgs to J psi plus a photon as bound on the charm Yukawa. A bit depends on our knowledge about the couplings to photon, of the Higgs to photon. And we can have direct bound, unavoidable bound on the this Yukawa, on the charm Yukawa from the bounds on the total width. And I mean the direct bound from the bright Wigner shape that we see from the peak shape. There's a bound at the order of 1 to 2 GeV on the total Higgs width, and this gives us some information upper bound on this Yukawa. On the top, as we said, as we see before, we can have information, direct information from the TTH, and both of them from the global analysis of the Higgs data. All this will lead us to the conclusion that the charm Yukawa is really smaller than the top Yukawa, and we see this all in all of these ways. Let's start off for the recasting of Higgs to BB bar. This is quark anti-quark go to off-shell vector meson, which emit Higgs, which decay to BB bar. Need to tag these two Bs. There is acceptance for charm, so we don't really sensitive only to the bottom signal strength, we're sensitive to the bottom signal strength, plus some factor which is roughly the efficiency for both charms over the efficiency for bottoms times the signal strength of Higgs to charm. So what we measure is really one linear combination. In each of this measure, we measure one linear combination of Higgs to charm plus Higgs to bottom. And if you have two different ratio, two different working points with different efficiency, we can disentangle this measurement and get some information about the mu c. In the standard model, mu c is 1, so what of the colloboy? Up to now, this part was neglected, but we want to test the Higgs to charm coupling, so we can use this. This is the direct constraint on the charm signal strength. So that's how it looks in our recasting. So what we see, the green are the Atlas working point, two working points. So we'll see one working point is this two parallel line, and the other is this. And we have the CMS is the orange ones. The CMS has four working points. And we put all together and do the log likelihood or the chi-square. And we get these two ellipses in the mu-b, mu-charm plane. So we get some constraint. It's a weak constraint at the order of 300 over mu-c, much above the standard model. And our next step is to interpret this constraint as coupling on the charm mu-kawa. So if we assume that the VH production is standard model-like, we get that we can, it cannot, the mu charm cannot be more than 30. It's just because the coupling to a vector field is already, we have previous knowledge from the lab experiment, that it can not much deviate from one, and this is just 1/3% branching ratio to charms. So we can, naively, we said we cannot say too much about the charm Yukawa. But in case of crazy charm Yukawa, that it's above 50 of its standard model value, there is another VH production which we should be taking into account. The charm and strange, that charm go emit Higgs, and there's a charm here in the T channel, the strange and emit a W. And there is another equivalent diagram with the Z, CC bar. And this gives us enhancement, and this start to be efficient where kappa C is above 50, and we see this enhancement as a function of the kappa C, which gives us some sensitivity to the charm Yukawa, and we can put the and we can put the direct bound of 250, where there's no runaway behavior of this, that this mu C can be much more than 30, and we can interpret the measurement as upper bound on the charm Yukawa. Now, second way to do it, to get some information, is in interpretation of the recent ATLAS result about the Higgs to J psi phi, J psi plus gamma. It's a really recent result. The original proposal to measure J psi plus photon, this exclusive mode was by Patriello, Frank Patriello, Bodian, Stonaev, and Valesco 1.5 years ago. And this is the expected rate. The upper bound is around 30 femtobound. This by itself, it's a bit, by itself don't tell us too much. We need to get rid of the production in order to say something fundamental, something about the ratio of the partial widths. So we choose, one way is to normalize to ZZ star, because this is pretty clean. And in both mode, there is a relatively good cancellation of the production, both are exclusive measurement of the Higgs production. We expect this mode, the production to cancel, which gives us, theoretically, we have this ratio of 2.8 times 10 to the minus 2, some combination of the couplings to Higgs to photon, to charm, and to vector fields, and to the W and the Z, this kappa V square. And from the experiment, we can take the signal strength of Z to Z star, and put upper bounds at the 95 confidence level on this ratio of roughly 9.3. And taking this plus this, we get this kappa C. It will be smaller than 210 kappa V plus 11 kappa gamma. Now with the kappa V from LEP, from the electroweak fit done quite a time ago by Falkovsky and Riva, it cannot deviate much from one, let's take it to be one, and under the assumption that kappa gamma is not crazy, it's all order of one or two, this can be interpreted as another upper bound on the charm equal.
What's this kappa V?
It's the coupling of the Higgs to W and the Z normalized to the standard model.
Why does that put a limit on this?
On the S&T parameters, its contribution. It's indirect. It's indirect, LEP, Yes. The third exercise that we did is in this direction is taking the total width of the Higgs. Taking the total width that quote by the collaboration, which is between 2 to 3 GeV, just from the shape, and give us upper bound on the kappa C of 150 on 120. And now the information about the top, this 2.41 plus minus 0.8, we can interpret it as lower bound, just lower bound on the top Yukawa of 0.9. And in the units of the charm standard model, you cover 250. Let's combine this with the three piece of information before. We see from all this measurement that YC is indeed, under different analysis, is smaller than the Y top. A few words about the global fit analysis. If we do the global fit, take all the Higgs data, then the upper bound, the 95 confidence level upon the charm UCAR, which is driven by the untagged, will be at order of 6. And it's mainly driven by the fact that the VBF production. One way to see that there is a measurement of the VH production to a WW star, which is sensitive only to kappa V. If we take this to zero, it's kappa V to the fourth over the ratio of the total widths. And given that this cannot be very different from one, we have some strong bound on the total Higgs width relative to the standard model, which give us bounds on the non-standard model decay of the Higgs, in this case to charm. But in the crazy case of non-standard model Yukawa, we have a new production of the VBF. It's a small production, we check it. This is this production with relative, for different Yukawas, as a function where we normalize this Yukawa to the standard model bottom Yukawa, and the most efficient, it's just taking the quark anti-quark from the PDF. It's when the up Yukawa is larger than the standard model, much larger, because it's in the, it's about, for here, it's about 8 times of the standard model bottom Yukawa, then we double the VBF production. This is, it's a small effect, but it can be important effect in precision measurement. It's a new production mechanism. And if we don't have any other information about the light Yukawas, then we can take this and normalize the ratio to other machines, take the ratio of the signal strengths from hadron colliders to E plus E minus colliders, and this in some sense can be sensitive to this production mechanism. There's sensitivity to this non-standard model production mechanism, not in the decay, but in the production. So it's in the inverse way that we can do it. Yes. And there's an issue with the electron Yukawa here.
I'd also make the point that the kinematics of the extra process that you're considering is going to be different from the kinematics that's going through a direct virtual vector boson. And in principle, the experiments can figure out the kinematics of vector boson plus Higgs production, so it might be able to give you a stronger constraint than what you were thinking.
We take in our all these plots, we take the experimental cuts into account, and I agree that the kinematics are different, but you need the differential analysis of the kinematics, I think, no? It's the acceptance is different, I agree. That's why with the enhancement that we get is a bit smaller than what we expect at the beginning, because we take this cuts into account. And for example, see all these different cuts are different for different kinematical cuts are different from what we expect for the standard model. And this effect is encoded in this plot.
Well, I was even thinking that you could cut away the standard model contribution so that you would only pick up your new contribution. If you look at invariant masses of the vector boson plus the Higgs, which are significantly larger than the minimum, I know.
Yes, it can work in principle. It's roughly what we get that for different PT cuts here, you get a different enhancement.
Oh, yeah.
It's the same effect. So now we combine all the cuts in the kappa C, kappa B plane. So the blue is from the Higgs 2 BB Barry casting, 1 sigma and 2 sigma are this gray. And from the total width is this curve and this curve, depends if you take ATLAS or CMS result. From J psi, it depends only on kappa C. So this plane, and the best fit point from the global fit, as we said, the upper bound on kappa C is when we're profiling over all the other standard model, all the other X coupling is 6. This is the best fit point. And we could put in this plot of the mass of the fermion versus its Yukawa. So this is the top, the bottom, the tau, and the muon, which is just upper bound, and we put here the charm. and compare the different bounds from the green is from the width, CMS and Atlas, and the orange is from the JPSI, and the blue is the direct bound. Now let's move to the exclusive way, to the exclusive window onto the Higgs-Yukawa couplings. So the indirect constraint, it's for not only for the can be not only done for the champ, can be also done for the other light Yukawas and the off-diagonal, of course, just from the Higgs data, are all at the order of the bottom Yukawa. In this fit, you do a different assumption. If we modify only one of the relevant Yukawa, we get the number outside the parentheses. The number inside the parentheses, and we allow all the Higgs coupling to flow, to vary, not to be in standard model, and profiling over them. But the message here, that all of them can be as large as the standard model bottom Yukawa, which is the main decay mode of the Higgs and in the standard model, and compete with them. In the off-diagonal, there's FCC, not robust bounds. They are model dependent. And we can see that some approximate flavor symmetry that can make this bound much weaker than the naive way. And if we see this, we see a different Higgs phenomenologically and this important effect, and lead us to look on the exclusive decay, because for the up, down, and strange, it's very hard to do it in the inclusive way. So what is this exclusive? It's the Higgs decay to some vector meson and a gauge field, gamma, W, and Z, where the W and Z are work in progress. The Higgs to J psi gamma is calculate what we discussed before. And we focus on the phi, rho, and omega, which are, in principle, can probe the strange Yukawa, the down, and the up. We'll see that these branching ratios are very small, but they reduce the QCD background by a lot and can help us to get some knowledge about these couplings and maybe probe them if they are above the standard model value. This can be done also for the off-diagonal couplings, where this B, you give me the off-diagonal Higgs coupling, we'll find the vector meson that is sensitive to it. In principle, all the diagonal couplings have the same structure. There is the direct amplitude, which is the Higgs split to quark anti-quark, and the photon is emitted from one of them, and the quark anti-quark hadronized to the relevant vector meson, and the indirect amplitude. Can you repeat again?
It's obvious that there is no loop effect. This is the
effect.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Higgs to gamma gamma, and we check against the Higgs to glue glue. That there is, these are the two main contribution. The indirect, which is Higgs to gamma gamma, and the okay, no problem. So we have the Higgs that splits to photon to two photons, and the one of the photons splits to quark anti-quark, which hadronizes to the relevant meson. This indirect is not sensitive to the Yukawa, but is the largest contribution. It's like the photon rho mixing or other vector photon vector meson mixing. And this is the largest contribution if the Yukawa of the relevant modes are the order of the standard model bottom Yukawa. Which means that the main sensitivity to the Yukawa is due to the interference of the Yukawa, the interference between these two diagrams. This is give us the some sensitivity to the Yukawa.
But it's not just photon here. It's not just photon. You have also virtual Z.
Yes, but it's suppressed. We take this into account. We check this suppressed. We have also the glue-glue that is suppressed. Glue-glue is suppressed. We check it. It's higher twist effect. You need glue-glue and photon emitted just from this, which makes that it's suppressed by the mass of the vector meson over the mass of the Higgs square. So we check these effects. And the result are quite small branching ratio, where we normalize to the Higgs to BB bar branching ratio. We avoid the discussion about the total width, which is a fact. We see that this is the contribution from the indirect amplitude square, and this is the interference effect. We quote here a certainty of 10%. It's mainly come from higher order correction, the renormalization scale, and the one parameter that entered to this uncertainty is the vector meson decay constant, but this can be improved both theoretically and experimentally, this uncertainty. And this uncertainty is what determined how sensitivity we have in the collider because we need to perturb to have some perturbation about the main of the interference about this main contribution. And these are the relevant poles relevant branching ratio of rho gamma and omega gamma. The first and the third are order of 10 to the minus 6, and the Higgs to rho gamma, it's order of magnitude larger, and for FCC-ee plus E minus, this is the most promising mode, as it has the largest number of events, and we have to hope to trigger this rho, and which leads us to the future prospects. So this, if we take the high luminosity projection of Higgs to BB bar, and project it, so we see that this ellipse is shrink by order of magnitudes, and of course with charm tagging, this will be much smaller because the efficiency will be much larger. And for hadron machine, Higgs to phi gamma is the most promising channel, and we can, given that the theoretical uncertainty will shrink smaller than the statistical uncertainty, we can probe a strange curve of order of 6 from the standard model. And here I did some naive estimation for E plus E minus collider. So we expect to 2 times 10 to the minus 6 event, and I did this also for 10 to the 7 events. So Higgs to rho gamma is the one that the largest number of event. And the sensitivity, we can have sensitivity here at the order of half of the standard model bottom gamma of direct probing. This is 3 sigma sensitivity, so which that's the bound will be stronger, much stronger than 2 sigma bound, or if it's still, this is consistent with current data, this half of the standard bottom gamma, it can be directly probed in a future E plus E minus machine. This is the result of the other modes, which are much weaker. Let me summarize. Modification in the Higgs to light quarks couplings lead to change in the Higgs phenomenology. The charm Yukawa can be probed by charm tagging or with exclusive decay. These two efforts are important. Higgs quark universal is established in the up sector also. Light quarks Yukawa to up, down, and strange can be directly probed in the exclusive decay. And for E plus E minus collider, Higgs to phi rho, Higgs to gamma rho is the most interesting channel to probe the up or the down Yukawas, a combination of them. That's all. Sorry for taking 1 minute.
No, thank you.
Hey, Yotam. Universality is established in the up sector because the charm kappa c is less than, say it again?
Kappa c less, the 250, and the top is above it.
Right. So kappa c, what is the bound that you quote for kappa c, sorry?
250. It's
250.
Roughly, and there are stronger bound from, for example, from the...
Now...
is from the total width is 120.
120. Now, so suppose it's 100, right? I mean, does it pays to try to wonder how that can be made consistent with what we know about flavor or not? You know, understand this sort of directly phenomenological point of view, which is fine, but I wonder if you see my question?
Oh, this is just a. This is flavor conserving couple.
No, I understand, but
this is from point of view of flavor changing.
I understand, but you could ask if it is possible to have a coherent theoretical scheme in which you include that, and all what we know about flavor remains consistent. I think it's a valid question. I don't know.
Yes, it's a fair question. In the previous study that we look on the constraint from the indirect constraint from the whole X data where this kappa C is about is the bound is roughly 6. It's a stronger bound, an indirect bound. We found a few models that can give us without contradiction with the data. One example, just an example that we choose to
with
pick
six,
up.
With 6?
With 6, yes. Okay. For this, there's no problem. This is much more challenging, yeah. I agree. And I need to think, I try to calculate if it is above 4 pi or not, this number, 120, because if it's above 4 pi, it's strongly coupled, this Yukawa is not perturbative, it makes much more problem. But this is from phenomenological aspect of view, just the direct bar that we can put now. That's the aim of this study. No, it's better because the bottom is 2%. It's less than one, so it's okay. It's less than the top, so it's less than one. No problem about the perturbativity. The top is one. It will not be easy to construct a model like this, but you can try to look it after the session. Yeah.
When you use the total width constraints, why don't you use the 22 MeV from CMS, on-shell, off-shell, H?
Model-dependent.
Model-dependent, yeah.
Model-dependent, but if and
you,
it's...
You don't... Why? I mean, okay, so we know.
We want something that it's really model-independent, and it's very hard to avoid this. In that sense, the both CMS and Atlas off-shell measurement, it suffer from quite theoretical uncertainties. And this bound is model dependent. There's quite few works about this.
But you are from 2 GeV to 22 MeV. I mean, the theoretical uncertainty is.
Yes, I agree. And
it's extremely conservative. I mean, no.
Yes, the new physics that can that it's not all the models that you construct will pass that this measurement can be interpreted as bounds on the total width. There's a few works about this. So that's why we want something more robust. In this way that. In this spirit, we quote the bounds from the from the old Higgs data, which is also model dependent, and is at the same order.
Okay, so let's thank Yotam for the first time. So we come to the second session now.